extreme danger, and I'm going to reveal why in three simple, fast steps. Step number one, let's go over the basics of how passive funds actually work. And before we dive in, I want to quickly dedicate this video to my good friends, Kim and Robert Kiyosaki. I was talking to Robert the other day. He says, George, you got to get some of those fat whiteboard pens so I can see what's going on. So Robert, this is for you. And a big shout out to my buddy, Jason Hartman, who actually got these pens for me right here in St. Bart. So guys, this video is for you. But it starts off with these financial advisors and people on CNBC and these YouTube gurus that say, listen, forget all that active management. You don't need to pay those fees. Just go into one of these passive index funds. It just puts your money and mimics the S&P 500. That's all you need to do. Just set it and forget it. And in 20 or 30 years when you retire, you're going to be rich. So all of these people buy into that. They kind of get brainwashed into thinking that they can have a higher return without doing any work themselves or without an active manager having to do work for them. There's no need to study the fundamentals. There's no need to look at profit or returns or future potential for a business. Who needs that? All you have to do is buy the whole thing. As an example, before Jack Bogle passed away, one of his famous sayings was you don't have to find a needle in a haystack, just buy the whole haystack, right? It's easy. So all these people buy into that nonsense and they put their money straight into this mega fund, this passive mega fund. We'll call it the Kool-Aid mega fund because of course they're all drinking the Kool-Aid. And JB right here runs the fund. We'll call him Jack Bugle. And Jack Bugle is holding a sign that says passive rules. And he's handing out the Kool-Aid like it's going out of style. So let's think through JB's process of how he determines which stocks he's going to buy and which he's going to sell. It's pretty easy. There is no process. Every dollar that comes in to the fund just goes directly into the stock market and buys the underlying assets. The only decision process they have is if a dollar comes in, a dollar has to buy. If a dollar goes out, a dollar has to sell. The problem with this is it wildly distorts the market itself, and it creates a total disconnect between prices and the underlying fundamentals of the stocks or the assets themselves. Here's how it works. We have our small stock market that has company XYZ, ABC, 123. We'll say there's only 100 shares in total. And if money comes into the Kool-Aid mega fund, JB has to buy at least one share of these companies because his fund represents the stock market. It's a reflection of this market. Well, this individual in the corner is an active manager. His name is Hugh Hendry, a good buddy of mine right here in St. Bart's. Hugh is up there chilling with his surfboard in his share of company 123. Now, Hugh may be a great guy, fun to hang out with, that's for sure, but he is a very shrewd active manager, a smart, smart guy. He bought this share of 123 at, let's say, $10 because of the financials. The PE ratio, was it cheap, was it expensive? He looked at the macro picture, the management of the company, and their business model. But JB doesn't care about any of that. If 123 has no profit, no problem, still has to buy. If the macroeconomic picture doesn't look good, let's say due to the cerveza sickness, and 123 has a horrible future, no problem. JB still has to buy. Or like BlackBerry, if 123 just had declining everything, no problem. JB still has to buy. So Hugh, being the sophisticated investor he is, knows this. If he bought the stock for $10, that's its fair market value. JB comes in and says, Hugh, I'll give you $20 for that share. And Hugh says, no, I don't think so. And JB says, I'll give you $50, $100, I'll give you $500 for that share of 123 because I have to buy it regardless of the price. So the transaction happens. Now JB has the shares he needs, so his fund reflects the underlying assets. But now we have this huge disconnect. If a high enough percentage of assets go from active to passive, the tail wags the dog. Let me explain it this way. The passive fund is supposed to track the performance of the underlying asset, but now the performance of the underlying asset tracks the fund. Step number two. Now let's go over the numbers, and they are shocking to say the least. Editor, let's throw up the chart. Here is the percentage of measured equity assets under passive management. We'll look at the United States, we'll focus there. In 2003, under 10%. Since 2003, it's gone up to almost 50%. So let that sink in a moment. According to The Economist, almost 50% of the equity assets under management are managed by a passive fund that has no decision-making process whatsoever. There is zero analysis other than if money comes in, they buy, and if money goes out, they sell. How can we expect the stock market to reflect the underlying fundamentals of the economy if almost 50% of the people who are buying aren't paying attention to the fundamentals at all? Oh, but wait, there is more. Vanguard and its two peers, who are BlackRock and State Street, manage assets worth $15 trillion. BlackRock itself, the largest of the big three, has increased client assets 20 times to over $7 trillion just over the past 15 years. And we haven't even talked about moral hazard. These funds aren't just indiscriminately buying shares, they're also buying shareholder votes. Let's keep that in mind. Even Jack Bogle of Vanguard, not to be confused with Jack Bogle of the Kool-Aid Mega Fund, of course. When Jack Bogle passed away last year, he actually wrote, if index funds owned more than 50% of the stock market, it would not serve national interest, which is a dramatic understatement, to say the least. More on that in step number three. Step number three, how stocks can actually go to zero. And I know a lot of you right now are saying, George, take off that tinfoil hat. What are you talking about? But I would challenge you, hear me out, but make sure you're sitting down. This whole process we talked about in step number one can flow in reverse order. All we talked about is if the average Joe and Jane that's sitting there like zombies that have been brainwashed by all the YouTube gurus and financial advisors are just giving their money to the Kool-Aid fund. We discussed that. But what happens when those average Joes and Janes start taking their money out of the Kool-Aid mega fund? What does JB have to do? Maybe we've got demographics issues. We have all these baby boomers retiring. Well, they need that money to live. Maybe we have a panic in the market like March of 2020. Or maybe it's generational. We have a gradual outflow from the baby boomers while that capital and those assets aren't replenished by the millennials that don't have the money. They're straddled down by things like student debt. They were crushed in the GFC. The job market isn't what it was, especially now after the Cerveza sickness. So it doesn't matter if there's money coming in and money going out. It matters about on net balance, is there more money going in or is there more money going out? So let's assume now it's in reverse. There's more money flowing out of the Kool-Aid mega fund. To understand what would happen next, let's go to a podcast episode, one of my favorites, which this whole whiteboard video is based on, an episode from The Endgame with Grant Williams, Bill Fleckenstein, and Mike Green. Just FYI, I'm interviewing Grant this Friday and interviewing Mike Green the 1st of December. So stay tuned to those Rebel Capitalist show. But let's check out the clip.
The problem with that is that simultaneously, it also takes the volatility through the roof, right? And so if you think about what happens when you're making that last move where you're going from 99.9% passive to 100% passive, what price change is required to get that last active holder to sell, right? Like it's volatility like you can't even begin to imagine to the top side, right? But what happens if you are there, you're at 99.9% passive, 0.1% active, and for some reason, the passive decide to sell 1%. Right? What happens to prices?
Yeah.
Limit down? I don't know.
Beyond limit down. There's no go to zero.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? There is no way you can actually, because that's what markets are, right? Markets are the solution for transactions. Mm-hmm. Price that you see is the intersection of supply and demand, not in some theoretical sense, but it's the point at which buyers and sellers were able to meet and balance that book. Well, if there are no discretionary buyers that are capable of meeting the 1% redemption because they only have 0.1% of the capital, there's no price at which that market can clear, except zero.
So let's unpack this a little further so you can connect the dots. As we discussed in step number one, the passive funds drive prices way higher than they otherwise would be if left to the active managers alone. Remember, it goes from $10 to $100 up to $500. JB has to buy at any price. This creates the epic volatility Mike Green was talking about in the clip. But if JB has net outflows, meaning more people are taking money out of the Kool-Aid mega fund, he has to sell at any price. So if he has the share of 123 that he originally bought from Hugh, and Hugh likes the share, but he doesn't like it at 500, he likes it at $10, you'd have the opposite volatility, where instead of the price going way higher than it otherwise would be, it would completely crash down to a price way, way, way lower than where it currently is. Let's think this through. Hugh likes the price at 10, but currently it's at 500. JB goes to Hugh and says, Hugh, you gotta bail me out. I have to sell. And he says, I'll sell it to you for maybe $100. And Hugh looks at him and says, no, I don't think so. I've got my original 500 bucks. I'd rather keep it in my back pocket. So JB says, fine, Hugh, I'll sell it back to you at $10. I'll take a $490 loss just on this transaction. And Hugh says, okay, I'll buy it for $10. That is massive volatility to the downside and a huge, huge haircut, not only for the fund, but for the people who are invested in the fund. The passive investors, the average Joe and Janes that drank the Kool-Aid. The main takeaway is that active managers would put in a bid far lower than the current price. According to Mike Green, this was one of the big reasons we saw so much downside volatility back in March. But it also doesn't take into consideration the percentage of assets we talked about before. Let's just, as a thought experiment, take it to an extreme like Mike was talking about in the clip, where Hugh, the active managers, maybe only have 0.1% of the assets and 99.9% are now under the management of these passive fund guys like JB. And I wanna be clear, it doesn't necessarily have to be 99.9 and 0.1. We don't know where the line in the sand is. It could be at 60-40, 80-20. We just don't know. But the bottom line is these passive people, the outflows would exceed the amount of assets under management with the active fund guys. To put it into simple terms, if JB has $1,000 worth of outflows, he has to come up with the $1,000 by selling stocks. Well, let's say that Hugh or the active managers only have $500. Think about that. They don't have enough money in order for JB to satisfy his redemptions from the average Joe and Jane that are taking their money out. So what happens to the bid, or what happens to the price of the stocks that JB is trying to sell? There isn't a bid. There is absolutely no price at which those stocks will clear. In other words, they go to zero. So what can you do to protect yourself? You can start by checking out the pinned comment of this video, where I'm going to give you some suggestions, and I'd love to hear your feedback. For more content that'll help you build wealth and thrive in a world of out-of-control central banks and big governments, check out this playlist right here, and I will see you on the next video.